St. John's chapter 21 is the text for today as we close out our mission and evangelism month. The New Century Version translation is the one I selected, beginning with verse 15. When they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" Peter said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." And said to him, "Feed my sheep." Amen. This is my Bible, God's holy word. It is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God shall stand forever. This is my Bible. This is my weapon, the sword of the Spirit. Amen. Do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Then feed my lambs. And I want to talk from the question, where are the lambs? Where are the lambs? This passage is a post-resurrection scene in which Jesus publicly restores Peter to his rightful place among his disciples. Remember, Peter was the outspoken one of the 12 who always had the answer. Questions that were being asked. If you recall, there was an occasion when Jesus took the group up to the foot of Mount Hermon in Caesarea Philippi, and he asked them there a critical question regarding his identity. And as they stood there in the shadow of that great rock, Mount Hermon, grottos had been carved into the mountainside to hold statuettes to the Phoenician god Pan. In that place of once pagan idolatry, Jesus asked the disciples the question, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" While the other 11 responded with commentary extracted from the crowds cities that they had visited, it was Peter who responded with these words, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." We cannot help but remember Peter, the one who said that he would die for Jesus, although others would forsake him. He told the Lord, "These brothers might forsake you, but I'm willing to die for you." He's the one that tried to prevent Jesus from going into a hostile environment that was stirring against him in Jerusalem. You remember that's when Jesus told him, "Get behind me, Satan." You remember he's the one who attempted to decapitate a soldier in the Garden of Gethsemane. Missed his head but caught his ear. The soldiers who had come to arrest Jesus He's the one who soon afterwards fled after Jesus had been taken into custody to begin the mock trial that led to his crucifixion. Peter was the one who warmed his hands over a fire as he watched from a distance the interrogation of Jesus. He's the one who, when asked of his association with the Lord, he denied three times that he even knew the man. So here we are now in this text, observing the restoration of that same Peter to his rightful place within that circle of trusted disciples. Jesus knew the plans that he had for Peter's life. He knew the plans that he had for the ministry that he had deposited within Peter. And in order for Peter to be forgiven by his peers for forsaking and denying that he even knew Jesus, the Lord had to publicly restore him. But had this not occurred, Peter would have faded into obscurity because of the guilt and the shame associated with his decision to deny that he even knew Jesus. Had not this restoration had happened, he would have been held captive to that denial by his contemporaries. However, Jesus chose to reestablish this brother in front of all of the remaining disciples, for if he had not done so, they would have forever held Peter hostage to his last mistake. Secondly, Jesus needed to restore Peter for Peter's sake. Oftentimes, forgiving ourselves for our past sins and failures is something that can be very hard to do. And for some, it's something that they can never seem to do. Instead of repenting, they find themselves repenting their sins upon themselves. And so it is here, in that dawning light after dining, with the sound of the waves breaking upon the shore, Jesus, in an effort to restore Peter and prevent the repenting of his failures upon himself, he pours a question to him that became the mandate for every minister whom the Lord has called into the preaching ministry, into the pastoral ministry. He said to him, "Simon, do you love me more than these?" He said, "You know, Lord, yes, I love you." He said, "If you love me, then feed my lambs." And this is still the role. This is still the responsibility of every pastor and every preacher of the gospel who mounts the pulpit today. Feed the lambs. Jesus also told Peter to feed the sheep, the mature. But he began with, "Feed my lambs." Feed those who are newly born into the flock. Feed those who have just come to know me as their shepherd. Feed my lambs. And I concur with Jesus, for this is the work of the pastor. I agree with this wholeheartedly. He is to feed the lambs, and shame on him and shame on her if they fail to do so. No preacher should ever claim to be called and sent by God to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ if he or she fails to feed the lamb. This is the work of the pastor. This is the responsibility of the shepherd. This is a mandate from the master. Feed my lambs. And if the flock of God, the church, is to grow, then the under shepherd, the pastor, must lead the flock and feed the lambs. The writer of the book of Hebrews says that the pastor must give an accounting for every member, for every sheep entrusted to his or her care as he watches over their souls. I'm going somewhere. So therefore, because of the seriousness of the call and the charge and the accountability to which he or she is held to for the welfare and spiritual health of the flock, the church, they have to feed the lambs. You know, sheep is one of the biblical metaphors for the people of God. There are others in the scriptures, but for this presentation, for this conversation I want to have with you this morning, I want to just focus on the sheep metaphor. We hear the term falls from the lips of Abraham as he stood on the summit of Mount Moriah and said to his son Isaac, God will provide himself a lamb